Welcome to the Grok Shop. In today's video, guys, I'm going to be showing how I've been working on this sort of odd size garden. It's got odd dimensions because I had to put it in a pre-canned area in my yard that was available. To make that work, I decided to use this tool SketchUp. It's a free tool that was originally developed by Google. It's still free for personal use, and I'll show how to download it and whatnot here in a minute. But the tool is useful probably for any number of construction projects that you might have going on. I'm sure I'll be using it again in the future. So you can think of this as like a case study in how to use this tool at the introduction level. Right, so besides helping construct sort of difficult or odd shaped constructs, there's other things you can do with this tool that saves you headache. One would be like calculating square footage or even cubic yards, as you can see I'm doing right here. I guess it'll come out to be, I ended up ordering 4 yards, showed 3.7, and yeah, I did have a good about half a yard left over. Depends on how compacted the soil is and whatnot. But ended up coming up pretty accurate, so I was pleased with that calculation. So besides the cubic yards or square footage, another good example of something you can do with this tool would be to generate a cut list, so you get the most efficient way to cut your boards down and with the least amount of waste, making things a little more cost effective. So yeah, here I'm showing you, you know, how you can get this tool. Be aware there's two kind of versions of the tool. There's a web-based version you run in your browser, which I'll show here first, and then there's a desktop version. You know, the web version's okay. You know, you can probably do enough for, you know, basic projects and stuff on there. You know, if you like that kind of a thing, you know, like save your project online. But me personally, I always prefer to have a local version. It's just you can't beat the speed of a local application. It's more responsive, and I like having all my data. I like to be in control of my data. That's just how I like to do it. But just to show you here, you know, this is what it looks like when you run it on the web. It's actually pretty cool. They must have spent many long hours to get that to work, but I won't be using that. I'll be moving on here to show you how to run the local version. Here you can see they call the local version SketchUp Make. So I'll put the links on how to download this, but you want to go ahead and download it if you want to run the local version, install it, and once you're done, you'll get started off with something like this. Notice in the bottom right down here, you can see my mouse and keystrokes. So that just gives you an idea of what I'm actually doing, so you're not completely lost while I'm doing all this stuff. If you press and hold the middle mouse button, that's how you can kind of navigate, change your view of everything. Okay, I'm going to start out by just pulling out some pre-canned lumber from the 3D warehouse. So go to the what they call the tray area, pull down component, and then under 3D warehouse, search for 2x and or 2x12, and that's what I'm going to use. You can do 2x8, or it's pretty easy to resize them, but I'm going to go ahead and just pull up 2x12s to make it easy here. And then basically you download it into your model. Now, when I first started, I actually built my own lumber, which you can do, but it's obviously easier to use something pre-canned. Go ahead and align your lumber to the axis here. So what this is a component, they call it. It's like a three-dimensional object. And when you see the blue lines all the way around, you know you've got it selected. For now, I'm going to delete this guy. They can be nice to give perspective sometimes, but I just right-click and erase. All right, so you see the one I selected is a 2x12x16, and I'm gonna show how to resize that. But here I'm just gonna use this measuring tape so we can see the actual dimensions. Here you can see it's a real lumber, where, you know, it's 1.5 wide instead of 2 wide. And there you can see 16. Now, in order to resize these, you can use this what they call the scale tool, and you can Once you select the object with the scale tool, you'll see these green handles. They turn red to signify the one you're about to operate on. Operate on the one in the middle to just change this length dimension here. And of course you can do it manually, but usually you know, you want to get an exact size. So what you can do is once you've got that dimension selected, you can literally just type in the length. So here I'm going to type in 12 feet and it'll actually set it exactly to 12 feet. Of course, I have to use the measuring tape to confirm everything, even though I know it's 12 already. I just love this measuring tape. After you get to using the tool for a while, you kind of get familiar with the shortcuts, like you can press S for scale, M for move, Q for rotate, which we'll get into here in a minute, and I believe T for measuring tape. All right, so I'm going to go ahead and make these into 8 foot, 2x12x8. So we'll just make a simple square just to illustrate the process. All right, so here you'll see where it didn't actually go to 8 when I told it to. Every once in a while I get that where it doesn't seem to do what I think it should. I'm not totally sure if it's me or not. It's probably something I'm doing since I'm a noob at this too. If anybody who knows comes along, let me know in the comments below. I'd appreciate you. But usually it works on the first try, and if not, the second try gets her. So just to show another way to select objects is you can use the area select when you got that little pointer selected, like in the top left in the toolbar up there. You can select multiple objects that way if you want. Now right here, I'm going to show how you can copy something. If you have it selected and you hit M for move or select move and then hit control, that actually puts you in a copy mode. And then you just drag out of the original object and you'll get a duplicate of the object there. It's a pretty handy way to duplicate objects. Here also you can tell it when you start pulling out, hey, I want this to be 8 feet away from where it originally was along the axis which you started, and it'll actually figure that out for you, which is pretty amazing feature of the software that can kind of like, they call it inference, which makes sense because it infers what you want to do. It doesn't always infer correctly, of course, but most of the time it's pretty impressive. All right, so now I'm going to use the same method to make a couple more copies. So we'll get all four pieces of lumber going. All right, so now we need to do some rotating. So the little bi-directional circle up there is the rotate. You can click that, or you can hit Q for rotate. And then to rotate, once you have an object selected, pretty much you need to, I'm not in rotate mode here again. We have a rotate mode going again here. There we go. Now you'll get this little protractor. So all you need to do is select a point that you want to rotate around and then move up the axis and left click it, and then you'll get a swinging pendulum action. And it's pretty easy to rotate about any point along an object. Also very, very cool. I really like that a lot. It's so simple to use. And then of course, if you have these axes going, everything will kind of snap to the axes. All right, so when I moved the first piece out 8 feet, what I should have done is move it 7 feet, 10.5 inches, because the width of the board is 1.5 inch. And so we ended up being out the 1.5 inch, which is the width of one board. Or actually, the easiest way to do it would have been to move relative to the origin or the other side of the board 8 feet. But anyway, get this board here positioned, and then we'll move the other board back 1.5 inches. So here we go, just use the same technique as before, put it in move mode, and instead of control, just start dragging along the red axis, and then type 1 1/2 inch, and it'll be perfectly positioned, like so. So be aware, like when I say drag in this tool, you select the object and then you let go of the mouse, and then you just move the mouse in the direction you want to go. It's not like you're pressing and holding the mouse button. So it's a little different from kind of other tools you may have used that way. We'll go ahead and rotate this other board around. So just like you can type in distances, you can also type in angles. If you look at the bottom right now, it's showing angle in degrees, which of course we want 90 degrees, but just to show, you can actually type it in. I'll do that here. So even easier than having that fourth board copy, but at 90 degree angle, would be to just copy the far board that's parallel to this one. Use that same technique, the move, control, and then slide that mouse along the axis you want to go, then just type in the distance. And here again, I failed to take into account the width of the board. So it should have been 8 feet, 1 1/2 inches. And that would have been perfectly positioned to butt up against the ends of those other boards. Here, as you can see, it's overlapped in the corner right there. So I'll go ahead and pop it on out with that move, manually moving at 1.5 inches. All right, so now we have a pretty viable square garden. And what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna draw lines right along the inside border to close off the bottom face. For reasons unknown to me, the tool is not able to close off faces with component edges, even though they might be actually touching. You need to draw off, line it off so you can get that area enclosed just like so. Now if you go to the materials tab pull down and just select your material, you get like a paint bucket, just paint on whatever look you like. Now we can calculate the area. You can do area selected or area of the material, and here we'll calculate 62 square feet by 11/12 feet, because I want to go up to 11 inches deep. I don't want to go all the way to 12 inches deep on my garden. I like to have a little bit of room between the dirt and the very top of the boards. Here you can see how it calculates out. So by default, you'll get square feet. If you go to window, model info, units, you can change it to decimal, and then you can change it to be in inches or what have you. It might help make the calculation a little easier. So now you can do like a square inches, and you could just multiply that by 11 if you want an 11 inch depth on your soil. And then of course I'm using a web page to convert cubic. This gets you cubic inches, and then 98,208 cubic inches, and then you can use like an online tool like this to convert your cubic inches to cubic yards, because you don't want to go to your soil guy and say, hey, I need 98,000 cubic inches of soil. They'll go, hmm? So yeah, you got to get it to cubic yards. So there you can see it came up to be about the same, a little over 2 yards. And by the way, for all you normal countries out there who use the proper metric system, Have a good laugh on me. You know, I'm stuck in this world. I'm sure you guys do cubic meters or something. Anyway, here I'm going to show how you can add the guy back in. It's the same way we added the lumber. You just go to your 3D warehouse and navigate around. There's three-dimensional people or there's two-dimensional. Knock yourself out, but it can be helpful to like get a kind of idea, you know, how much space you've got like through the walkway. Like in my garden, I have an entranceway, and just to give a little perspective on things. See, one feature which I didn't really discuss much, or I don't think I discussed it at all actually, but used it a couple times, is you can use the arrow keys to constrain your object along an axis. So up, left, and right, I believe right constrains to red, up constrains to blue, and left constrains to green. Sometimes those can be useful when you're moving objects around. Once you get your person selected, you might find that you gotta rotate them around. Just rotate them just like any other object and you're good to go. So looking back at my garden design, one thing that I struggle with sometimes was keeping all of the objects aligned on the same axes. So I'm going to show you a little trick here that I found that helps with that a lot. So on the tray, if you go to the styles pull down, then go to edit. Edges and by axis, and you'll see that they light up. So here I just turned it off. By default I think it's all same, but if you put by axis, you'll see they're all the ones that have red edges here are parallel. So all those edges are parallel to each other. So if you happen to have an object that's off kilter, which can happen sometimes, it'll show up really well because it won't have the red edge. So just to give an example of that, I'll take one piece of lumber here and sort of tilt it back a little bit. Of course, the colors won't show up if the object is selected and highlighted in blue. So I'll just select another object, and now you can see the edges are all black there. So I'll just tilt it back and go ahead and select another object. See, we got our red axes alignment showing up again. So it's a pretty handy little trick. Here's one that's gotten out of alignment here. Yeah, this is where I was making my own lumber, and you can see if you don't componentize it, that one's still in individual pieces. It gets kind of messy. It's much better to use these pre-canned pieces of lumber. So you may have noticed my joints are a little loosey-goosey and spacious. That's because I use these pivoting junctions between my boards. And you can see it looks like in the final product here. It makes it really easy to have all these crazy angles. I'll put a link to those below, but they're definitely pretty handy. So that's how you can use SketchUp to do raised bed designs. Thanks for watching my video, and stay tuned in the future. I'll definitely have more SketchUp and garden videos to come.